So the food bank has a program that we call Food Connection. And what Food Connection does, Monday through Friday, during business hours, excluding weekends and holidays, we provide a service to the community where individuals can call an 800 number and in different languages, we have people in a call center and they request services, food services, through this this thing called the Food Connection, this program. We get some funding from the different county to provide this, from San Mateo and Santa Clara, to provide the service. So what we did in order to expedite the delivery of the service a long time ago, probably about 8-9 years ago, we developed a database that contains all the different agencies. Second Harvest Food Bank, as you may know, partners with over 600 different agencies that provide food to people in the community. We distribute 34 million pounds of food. That's annually. One of the things we do as a service for people who are out there in the community who don't know what to do if they're hungry, this is sort of a way to connect them to an agency that could provide service to them in the community. Generally, that's oftentimes things like they're a family, there's some requirements. They have to pass in order to get a weekly sort of food box or an emergency box. Mm-hmm. But anybody can go in and get a hot meal from a soup kitchen, right, without the need necessarily to go through a screening process or to be an official referral. So
they're already in the database, is what you're saying?
No, because soup kitchens are pretty much they're sort of
show up.
They're nondescript. It's anybody can walk in pretty much. So most soup kitchens and say, "I'm hungry, please feed me," because I'm in need of food right now. A lot of agencies that we provide service to as a food bank, it's more an ongoing sort of thing. It's a family that they go and they get a grocery bag once a month, and then that helps provide some sustenance. They go home and cook it. They're seniors and they get food in their homes. These are more like sustainable programs, but there's also sort of the short-term need that people have because they're hungry now, where can I get a meal, a hot meal? And so there are agencies, there's probably 20, 25, 30 agencies or so that provide this service throughout the Bay Area. And so those we just generally call them soup kitchens. So one of the things we decided at some point that would be great is if after hours on weekends, we exploited that database to provide, so when they called on the 1-800 number, that it could go to an IVR, and at least if they said they wanted a meal, they could type in their zip code and can tell them where the local soup kitchen is. Mm-hmm. So we've actually implemented that program in the English version of it starting July 4th weekend this last year. So now, beforehand, what would happen after hours, they would say, please call back during business hours, and one of our Food Connection staff would be happy to help you. Now what happens is that through an IVR script that I wrote, essentially they type in their database, their zip code, and it goes and searches the database for matching soup kitchens that serve in that zip code. Because as you imagine, a soup kitchen doesn't provide just service for that one zip code that they're in. They'll, a certain soup kitchen will provide service to surrounding zip codes.
Right.
So what we do is we make sure in the database that each soup kitchen has the zip codes assigned to it. Mm-hmm. And that's in the SQL database that I gave you. Those are in one table. Mm-hmm. I think that's the site service zip table. In that table, you have essentially a site service zip ID, and then you've got all the different zip codes that's associated to it. And so what happens when they call and they enter in their zip code, it goes and checks that table, and it says all these different sites that serve that zip code, select those. Select those rows in the database. And then what happens is it then goes and checks to see, what sites are those, and do those sites have a soup kitchen? Mm-hmm. Because some sites aren't soup kitchens. Some sites are, pantries. They just provide emergency boxes and such. So then the second loop of the IVR takes that zip code, and then it matches them to, it takes all the different sites that have been selected, and then finds which ones are matches that serve that are soup kitchens. And then what it does is it takes those, and maybe there's one or two, maybe there's three or four. It takes the first two, and then it basically finds a prompt, a pre-recorded prompt, and then puts that in the variable, and then plays back the pre-recorded prompt. You know, then it matches it. So it's essentially, it's a relatively simple program. And so what it does then, when the person calls up, it asks them, you know, for their zip code, and then it plays back the following sites provide service in your area, and then it reads them back in the order that it was matched.
Right.
And it'll only read two, because there could be more if it was a really dense area.
Right.
It could be none. If it's none, then they have a chance to enter another zip code, of course. And they can do that up to three times before it rolls over to the voice, you know, the Food Connection hotline. Typical sort of, you know, database query, IVR sort of system. And when we, you know, at some point I'll actually demonstrate that on the phone. So essentially, what we wanted to do then is say, okay, the next step to this would be was to provide a user interface using a web browser to do virtually the same thing. People could do it any time, and so they could go if they want to get if they want service from a soup kitchen, they can enter in a zip code, and what it'll do is it'll go to that same database.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And pull the information from that database and present to them to, you know, the local soup kitchens in that area, and then they can select to get directions from their location to that zip code, or they can have the address text to their phone. So we want to provide that option so that big, because that way they can just get, you know, they can enter in the phone number and the address could get sent via SMS to their phone.
For that piece, they would have to know their. I guess we need to who their carrier is. They got to provide what their direct phone SMS number is.
Yeah, I know. I've looked into this. It is a little bit more of a problem because you know the if it's depending on if it's Verizon or it's AT&T, mm-hmm. you're going to have a different suffix, and we don't currently have one of those numbers. You know, like text. You know, such and such.
Well, you don't need if you're sending out your short. You don't need a short code.
No, you need a short code just to query,
yeah,
right? Exactly,
right.
To query.
You can actually talk to the Ribbon guys. Mm. They're here, and they may open something up.
Yeah, because I know that there is some free. There is some open source code that you can actually run on a notebook where you could do at least. You know, you can send. You know, so you know that's something that I've looked into. I looked into that for the current system that we use. My IVR system uses Cisco CRS technology on the, using the, you're probably familiar with Contact Center.
So the end
Cisco
user is going to be the one on the computer using all this stuff?
Yeah, the end user is going to be the one basically.
But that's the person who's looking for the soup kitchen,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
So basically, the somebody, like for example, if we have this, if the food bank puts us at a library or a human resource agency.
Okay, I was going to say.